Well, welcome everyone. I am Steve Savant, your host for the Quest for Financial Freedom, brought to you by Brokers Alliance. Need financial guidance? Call Brokers Alliance. I want to welcome everyone listening on the Family Values Radio Network and over the World Wide Web on YouTube, Ustream, and Vimeo, and on our social network, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and the Insurance Forum. You can contact me on my email address, thequest@brokersalliance.com, or call me toll-free, 1-800-290-7226. It's not what I know, it's who I know. And that's why my special guest on The Quest is Ken Davis, Vice President of Advanced Marketings for Bell & Associates. Ken, welcome back. Day five.
Hey, Steve. Good to be back. It's been a fun week, and it's great to reconnect with you on a radio show like we used to do so many years ago.
Yeah, the Good Hands people used to sponsor us on our show called Money Manners right out of Phoenix, Arizona. It's like broadcasting from the surface of the sun. You know, Ken, I got to say, before we get into it, I know we want to talk about so many cool tax ideas to mitigate our, to reduce our taxes. That's our goal. And I'm looking, you know, we were talking about that China, you said this yesterday on the show, you said China, this is communist China, by the way. Communist China is concerned about our debt, because they're probably concerned about us paying them back, right?
Right.
I mean, because we're borrowing our money from them. I didn't know they had all this money.
I mean, think about it. If you were a bank and one of your borrowers increased the amount of money they're borrowing by leaps and bounds, and their debt's getting bigger and bigger and bigger, wouldn't you have a concern as a banker? Well, that's what communist China has become to the U.S. government, as their banker.
Well, here's what bothers me, okay? I'm looking at the debt clock again, and guys, I'm telling you, if you go on here, this will freak you out, because this totally bothers me. Not only do we owe China just regular bonds, right? Regular debentures,
sure, just government bonds.
Just regular bonds. We have, well, let's see, we have a $279 billion with a B trade deficit with China. I'm not talking about our total deficit. I'm talking about our deficit to China.
Right. We're buying more from them than they are us.
How can we have a deficit when 20% of the world lives in China? We should be cleaning up.
Oh, absolutely.
What is our problem? I mean, I have to look at this. And then, of course, I'm looking at our total imported oil. This is U.S. imported oil, right? $394 billion, and half of that's coming from OPEC.
Amazing.
I mean, when is this going to end? I just don't get it. U.S. debt, total debt. Now, this isn't just China now. This is everybody, right? Remember I told you we're, you know, whatever we are, we're at almost $4 trillion. Our total debt's like $4.7 trillion of U.S. debt held by other companies.
Countries.
Oh, I wish. I was hoping it'd be life insurance companies or somebody who's one of our big boys. I'm thinking about if you took all the people, the 500 richest people in the world, and they donated their fortunes to the United States debt, we'd still be in hock. You could tax the top 500 earners at the 50% bracket, which is exactly what this administration wants to do, right, before
yep.
we change. You could tax that, and it would be a drop in the bucket.
Oh, absolutely.
If you keep going after all the people who are, you know, I just want to go, Ken, I just want to, they talk about a fair tax. Why can't everybody contribute? Half the country is not paying taxes. How can we go on like this?
We just can't.
We got to rewrite the thing. Well, until they change, because this show is not a political show. This show is an economic show, although maybe they're one and the same.
Could be. Politics influences economics.
But Ken, you and I aren't going to change the world today, but we're going to try to help our clients and our listeners and our 250,000 advisors that get this show distributed to them every week. And we want them to help their clients. We're going to talk a little bit about this thing called laddering. No, it's not about fire, you know, trucks or, you know, anything else. We're talking about not mutual fund laddering, you know, and I've heard that before. But let's talk about laddering. Laddering is what? Give me the definition of laddering and then let's get into it.
Well, there's different kinds of laddering. You can ladder, you know, bonds where you have different maturities. You can ladder annuities with different maturities. And then you can do something where you ladder different kinds of tax-benefited vehicles. And what I mean by that more technical term is that IRAs are a tax-benefited vehicle. In other words, you put your money into it, you grow it, mm-hmm. no current taxation, deduction up front if it's a regular, if not, if it's a Roth, it's tax-free in the mm-hmm. end. But there's other financial products like annuities and life insurance products that will allow you to build on a tax-deferred basis and under certain circumstances potentially take it out tax-free. Capital gains assets, mutual mm-hmm. funds. If And unfortunately, the portfolios change rapidly, so they're constantly creating taxable gains. But if they bought the stocks and held on to them, much like some of the exchange-traded funds do, then they can defer those gains to a future year when they actually cash them out, or if the holder of the fund cashes them out, and under certain circumstances get favorable tax treatment. So deferral is a big deal. Deferral is an important thing. And in terms of laddering, I think the point I'd really like to make to our listeners is that we don't know what the tax law is going to be in 20 years. If we have IRAs, qualified plans, annuities, life insurance, savings accounts, ETFs, all this different stuff, the cool thing about layering or laddering and putting these together is you get choice. You get the choice of, gosh, now I get to actually see what the real tax law is 10, 20 years from now. And I can pick from these different choices as to where I want to get the money. If you put it all into qualified plans and a retirement plan, you got one pot to take the money out of, and you're stuck with whatever the rules are at that point in time. And we've seen those change over and over again.
I'm wondering if we had to do a strategy of tax-deductible qualified plans and tax-deferred but not deductible annuities or Roth IRAs, or tax-exempt or tax-free vehicles. Some might be municipal bonds, some might be life insurance, withdrawals to basis and policy loans to gain on a non-modified endowment contract. Sorry I had to say all that, but I just wanted to be compliant. You know, I'm just wondering, you know, I mean, you're saying, you're kind of bringing up a whole new idea. Laddering on time with bonds and annuities, we kind of got. I kind of knew that.
Sure.
You know, here's 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. You're just doing different CD laddering. I've heard CD laddering.
Sure.
But now we're talking about laddering as it relates to taxes. Is it taxable? Is it tax deferred? Is it tax free? Or a combination of all these three? And there's a reason to look at all these different venues.
Well, what's interesting, Steve, is I'm reflecting back to a conversation we had back in the late 90s when we were working together.
Oh, as if I remember that.
Hey, all I do, because it was a really good idea.
Was it on the show?
No, it wasn't on a show. It was just you and I talking in your office.
Well, I deny it if it's bad.
Basically, what you said is IRAs and qualified plans, one of the real powerful aspects of that is that each year that you get to defer taxes, it gets to grow on a pre-tax basis. If I'm forced to take distributions out to live on when I hit 65, but I have the right to defer it to 70 and a half, wouldn't it be nice to be able to tap some other asset to live on and let these powerful tax-deferred vehicles work that much better?
Keep rolling.
And keep rolling.
I mean, didn't Einstein say, not his theory of relativity, but he said compounded interest was great. And what about compounded tax-deferred interest? That's even better.
Well, absolutely. And so the point is that if you layer different types of tax strategy, tax-benefited assets, and there's lots of different financial contracts and ideas out there, if you have a potpourri of those and have them spread, you now have choices, and you can find ways to take the least hurtful tax cash distributions with the least amount of tax and let the other things grow and defer and build and compound.
I mean, if you think, if I'm hearing you correctly, let's say I had a lot of people may use non-qualified life insurance to store as a storing vehicle that can take it out tax-free through withdrawals to basis and policy loans to gain as long as they leave the contract in force.
Sure.
And I could take that money out when I go to retirement first. I wouldn't pay any taxes. And it wouldn't dicker with my Social Security benefits either.
That's exactly correct.
Okay, and then I'd be deferring my qualified plans all the way out until I'm forced with a gun to do the RMDs, the required minimum distribution. But I want to go one step further than that. There could be, in about, let's say you use the term, I think you said 65 to 70 or whatever, but that 5 year could be a whole cycle of a market.
Oh, it's huge. So, you could double your money in that period of time,
potentially. That could be something. So it's not only giving the market time to recover, the market a cycle to go up all the way around, but the tax deferring it, the ability not to pay taxes when it's growing like that.
Well, you know,
it's compounding.
That brings up a really good point, Steve, and the fact is timing is everything. If you hit retirement and all you had it in is mutual funds and you had to start distributing to live on in 2008 and early 2009, oh my gosh, you're having to liquidate at the lowest possible price.
And we had people that actually went through this.
Well, they went through that. If you had other choices that were fixed and guaranteed, that were much safer and didn't decline and participate with the decline in the market, such as fixed annuities, deferred annuities, life insurance, things like that, Then you could take money out of those things that didn't get hurt, live on that, mm-hmm. wait for the markets to recover. Because mm-hmm. really, one of the biggest issues that I learned in terms of financial planning is the market in the short run is very risky, very volatile. In the long run, if you look at the histories, it's been reasonably predictable, although it's a scary time now, and I have concerns about that. But these alternatives help reduce risk, mm-hmm. give you availability of liquidity when you need it, when other things mm-hmm. are down. And from a tax perspective, maybe the best choice to draw on. So there's a whole bunch of good reasons to layer in and spread. Just like we know not to put all our eggs in one basket when we're choosing our investments, mm-hmm. don't put all your eggs in one basket when you pick your tax-benefited vehicle.
Well, I'm thinking, you know, you've mentioned a couple of times, we didn't talk about this at all this week, but really there's huge tax advantages if it's done correctly with life insurance, depending upon what you're using it for, whether it's indexing or you're using dividend participating whole life. Some contracts are actually quite good, where you get the deferral and you pull the money out free.
Well, and let's talk to our listeners, because they don't understand some of this life insurance stuff. Mm-hmm. Life insurance is really two pieces. There's the pure life insurance piece, and then there's the cash value mm-hmm. piece. The cash value piece is what you can build tax benefited. The insurance there, if they have need insurance for the family and they want to accumulate wealth, they can do both together in the contract.
We're going to have to get into that in the second half, because I really want to make, because it's kind of, we're introducing a new idea,
right.
new concept that most people think, no, it's buy term, invest the difference, but it's not. Coming up in the next segment, we're going to continue with Ken Davis, and this time we're going to talk a little bit about life insurance as a tax advantage. You're listening to The Quest for Financial Freedom. We'll be right back after the break.
Economists call the first 10 years of the new century the lost decade, where most Americans experienced a level of unprecedented financial loss. But some savers and investors found one sector of products that actually made them money. Products that were guaranteed, tax-advantaged, and backed by some of the biggest names in the business. Now, focus on the returns on your money without worrying about the return of your money. For over 30 years, Brokers Alliance has maintained one of the largest inventories of guaranteed and tax-advantaged products in the country, and serves a nationwide network of financial